When and how to treat hypertension with medicines. Hypertension is very common in OPDs. So as a physician, we first have to decide whether we should start with the medication, and if medicines are being given, how to choose a particular agent and how to titrate the doses of antihypertensive medications. Before that, this video is only for medical professionals, should not be used as a prescription. If there is high blood pressure, patients are advised to consult their local physician, and there is no advertisement for any brand or company. Now let's see what is the meaning of hypertension, and these are based on International Society of Hypertension guidelines. So normal blood pressure is when the systolic BP is less than 130 and diastolic BP of less than 85. So both these should be fulfilled. While elevated blood pressure is 130 to 139, means both the values are inclusive in this group, and or diastolic BP of 85 to 89, means either of any these two will make it high normal blood pressure. Grade 1 hypertension is 140 to 159 and or diastolic BP of 90 to 99. Grade 2 hypertension more than equal to 160 and or diastolic BP of more than equal to 100. So this classify the patient in grade 2. For example, if a patient has blood pressure of say 130 by 100, so this patient will be classified into grade 2, because 100 diastolic BP will come in grade 2. Though 130 systolic BP is coming in high normal blood pressure, but the thing is and or. So this is how to classify the blood pressure. While Indian guidelines do classify stage 3 or grade 3 as when the blood pressure is more than 180 and or diastolic BP of more than 120. Now, how many readings are needed? For example, a patient coming to first time with hypertension, should we start with the antihypertensive medication or should we wait? So the guideline says that diagnosis should not be made on a single OPD visit. Therefore, we should have multiple readings elevated, after which we can label the patient as having hypertension. So there should be two or three visits, and the interval of those visits will be 1 to 4 weeks, and they are required to confirm the diagnosis. Now, in each visit, we should make 3 measurements with a 1 minute interval between them, and the average of last 2 readings will be taken as the actual blood pressure, because the first reading will be high most likely, because patient will be anxious coming to the OPD for the first time. So therefore, ignore the first reading and take the average of last 2 measurements. If the blood pressure reading of first reading is less than 130 by 85, then no further measurement will be needed. Diagnosis will be made on a single visit. If the blood pressure is more than 180 by 110 and there is evidence of some cardiovascular disease like CAD is there, or there is a history of stroke like that. So in that scenario, even a single reading will make a diagnosis of hypertension. Now, how to start antihypertensive medications? Guidelines, they vary from India to world. So these guidelines are on the International Society of Hypertension. Indian guidelines might differ because Indians have different phenotype. Indians have slightly high renin levels. So the choice of antihypertensive can be variable. So this is according to the International Society of Hypertension. So how the drug should be started? If a patient is diagnosed with hypertension, grade 1 hypertension, that means BP is 140 to 159 systolic and 90 to 99 diastolic. So we should assess these risk factors. If the patient is having diabetes, CAD, chronic kidney disease, or patient has risk factors for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Risk factors are dyslipidemia, smoking, sedentary lifestyles, family history at young age. So these are risk factor for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Or patient has hypertension mediated organ damage. For example, patient have hypertensive retinopathy, patient has albuminuria due to hypertension, or patient has evidence of ventricle hypertrophy. So these are all hypertension mediated organ damage. So if any of these is present, yes. So along with the lifestyle modification, we should start the patient on antihypertensive drugs. But if none of these are present, then we can continue with lifestyle modification, but keep the patient in follow-up. Like every 3 to 6 months, we will do the follow-up of the patient. And if the blood pressure is still high, then we will add drugs. While if a patient coming to us in grade 2, then lifestyle modification with drugs should be started in that patient. So this is a protocol how to start or when to start the antihypertensive medication. Now, what is lifestyle modification? Lifestyle modification has been discussed in a separate video. You can watch that video in the same channel, that is natural way to control blood pressure. Ki how much is the salt intake and everything practically is discussed there. Like guideline says less than 5 grams of salt should be taken. But what is the meaning of 5 gram practically? How will you advise your patient? Which fruits to be taken? How much exercise is important? What about the alcohol intake? So everything is discussed in that video. Now, coming to the drugs. How to start with the drugs, the protocol of starting the antihypertensive drugs. So the guideline says that you start with combination therapy. Like if patient does not have any comorbid condition or no special preference for any antihypertensive medication, so we can start with ACE inhibitor or ARBs plus CCB in a low dose. For example, low dose means half or less than half of the maximum dose. For example, see, telmisartan, if we are starting, so telmisartan we can start with a very low dose like 20 milligrams or a low dose 40 milligrams along with the calcium channel blocker like amlodipine we can start with 2.5 milligrams. So if the patient started on the low dose, just take an example, telmisartan of 20 milligram per plus amlodipine of 2.5 milligram. So we can start this medication. While you can also choose a telmisartan of 40 milligram and amlodipine of 5 milligram depending on the blood pressure range of the patient. Like if a patient is in grade 1 and BP is like 144 by say 92. So I would prefer giving a very low dose of telmisartan of 20 and amlodipine of 2.5. But if the patient has BP of say 158 by 98. So in that case, I will choose telmisartan of 40 and amlodipine of 5 milligram. So that is the clinician decision ki how much dose should be started in the beginning. Then we will call the patient after 1 to 3 months. Indian guideline says that you call the patient after a month. So after a month, if blood pressure is controlled, continue with the same previous doses. If blood pressure is not controlled, so these arrows are if blood pressure is not controlled after 1 to 3 months duration. So we increase the doses of these medications. For example, let's take an example. If in the first step, I have started the patient on telmisartan of 40 and amlodipine of 5 milligram and BP is still not under control. So what I will do, especially in young patient where the renin levels are high, I will increase the dose of telmisartan to 80 milligram. From 40, I will make it 80 milligram and I will keep amlodipine as 5 milligram only. And then I will call the patient again after a month. So again after a month, if BP is still not under control, so what I will do, I will then increase the dose of amlodipine from 5 to 10 milligram and I will keep the dose of telmisartan as 80 milligram. Like that I can take a decision. So it is the individual decision of the physician ki how the dose should be titrated. Now, if in spite of high doses means almost the maximum doses of these agent, blood pressure is still uncontrolled, then we will add diuretics. So, diuretic like chlorthalidone can be added. We start with a low dose, maybe 6.25 we can start, gradually increase it to 12.5, then 25, depending on the response of the patient. But still, even after the maximum dose of the diuretic, BP is uncontrolled. That is the meaning of resistant hypertension. Resistant hypertension means BP is more than 140 by 90 despite 3 or more than 3 antihypertensive drug and one of which is diuretic. Then it is resistant hypertension. So in that case, we will add spironolactone. Spironolactone, we first start with 25 mg once a day. Then if BP is still not controlled, we can make it 50 mg per day. And still BP is not controlled, then we will add further drugs that we will discuss subsequently. So this is a broad skeletal framework of how to proceed if BP is not under control. Now what is the target BP? When we say ki BP is not controlled, means what should be the target blood pressure? So the target blood pressure should be, in comorbid conditions, whether it is diabetes, CAD, CKD, keep the blood pressure 130 and 80 and below 130 and 80. If patient is young, if there is no comorbid condition, no hypertension mediated organ damage, so till 140 by 90 or below that, BP can be maintained. But most of the guidelines says that in comorbid condition or hypertension mediated organ damage or high risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, keep the BP 130, 80 or less than that. Now, if patient is elderly, frail or having a low CVD risk, in that condition, in grade 1 hypertension, we can start with a single agent also. We can start with a single therapy as well. Now, which antihypertensive agent we should choose? If there is a particular comorbid condition or a patient profile is given. So, for example, in this, if a patient has a CHF or fluid overload, so instead of giving the CCB, I will start with diuretic therapy. Like that, we can choose. So, depending on the patient profile, the initial agent can be variable. So, if patient is having CHF, patient is elderly or patient has isolated systolic hypertension, in that condition the preferred agent will be diuretic. But caution is contraindication is these thiazide diuretics, or especially the thiazide diuretic, should be contraindicated in gout. They can aggravate high uric acid. Relative contraindication is dyslipidemia patient, and these are the doses and frequency of popular diuretics. So hydrochlorothiazide dose is 6.25, a low dose to 12.5. chlorthalidone 6.25 to 12.5, but some says ki till 25 we can go with these agents. Frequency of hydrochlorothiazide can be twice a day, but for chlorthalidone it is once a day. Indapamide can be 1.5 to 2.5 and dosing frequency is 1. The timing of these agent, choose the timing morning or afternoon because of their diuretic effect. If you give them in the night time, so patient has to wake up multiple times in the night. So patient sleep will be disturbed and it is a precipitating cause for further hypertension. So these are some practical tips ki what time of the day you should give these agents. Now, if patient has metabolic syndrome, patient has angina episode, elderly patient and systolic hypertension. So in those conditions, we can choose calcium channel blockers. Especially for angina episode, we use non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers. We can choose diltiazem or verapamil. They will help in the angina episodes. And they will be preferred if patient has bronchial asthma, where in angina we can't give beta blocker. So we can give calcium channel blocker from that group. Contraindication of those non-DHP, diltiazem and verapamil is AV blocks. These are the doses and frequency per day. Like most popular is amlodipine, 2.5 to 20 milligram. 20 milligram is a maximal dose of amlodipine. Then we can choose these diltiazem. The doses are 90 to 360. They can be given in a sustained release formulation also. Nifedipine is now gaining popularity, especially the long acting nifedipine, a dose of 10 to 40 milligrams it can be given. So these are certain calcium channel blockers which are used. Then if a patient has metabolic syndrome, heart failure, especially heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, chronic heart failure, left ventricle dysfunctions are there, post myocardial infarction patient, significant proteinuria. So if patient has these comorbid issues and diabetes, so the obvious choice, now you can go guess what should be the obvious choice in these conditions. So yes, the answer is ACE inhibitor, or we can say ARB. ACE inhibitor have shown to have better efficacy in controlling the proteinuria than ARBs study wise. Contraindication is pregnancy and lactation, and bilateral renal artery stenosis and significant hyperkalemia. They increase the potassium level. So these potassium reports should be checked before starting the ACE inhibitor. Popular ACE inhibitor that we gave are enalapril, lisinopril, remipril, and these are the doses, out of which enalapril and remipril can be given in a twice a day frequency. They can be given. But if you are starting the ACE inhibitor first time, so what time of the day you will start? So it has been seen that if you give ACE inhibitor after dinner or in the evening time, that has a better effect in managing the early morning hypertension. So if first time you are starting, start with the evening time, and if you are increasing the dose, then you can make it twice a day. That means ki after breakfast and after dinner you can give these medications. While ARBs, that is angiotensin receptor blockers, most popularly we give telmisartan. Telmisartan range or dose is 40 to 160, but it is also in a 20 milligram. That is a very minimal dose of telmisartan. We can start with that 20 milligram as well. Maximum dose which we go usually is 80 milligram or 120 milligram. Here it is textbook wise has been given as 160, which we rarely go. Olmesartan 20 to 40 milligram it can be given, azelsartan 40 to 80 milligram, and all of these agent are given as single day frequency because they are almost 24 hour working. But you can split the doses, like telmisartan you can split the doses twice a day also, like 40 milligram morning, 40 milligram evening. Now if a patient has angina episode, post myocardial infarction, tachyarrhythmia is the issue, or heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is there, chronic heart failure, we can choose beta blockers. Contraindication if there is heart block. But beta blocker, only 3 beta blockers are approved for the heart failure condition: carvedilol, extended release metoprolol and bisoprolol. Not all the beta blocker are used for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And for angina, they are very good drugs. They help in the angina episodes as well as in the long term, they control the blood pressure. And as we have discussed, if an angina patient has asthma, so in that case, avoid beta blocker, give non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers. So these are the doses of metoprolol, like 25 low dose, go till 100 milligram. If you are giving extended release, only once a day is sufficient. Bisoprolol is 2.5 to 10, nevilol is 2.5 to 5. Carvedilol we can also give. Atenolol is less commonly used nowadays agent. While if a patient has prostatic hypertrophy, chronic kidney disease, in that case we can give alpha blockers. Alpha blockers are relatively safe in chronic kidney disease. But contraindication is patient has frequent episode of orthostatic hypertension with frequent falls, should be avoided, and congestive heart failure, it should be avoided. These are the dose of prazosin. We start with the 2.5 and it should be given in the night time, at bedtime, because after consumption patient should not walk, patient should lie down. So the best time to start with is the night time, 2.5 to 10. Though it can be given once a day, but we can increase the frequency to 2 or 3 times in a day as well. Resistant hypertension patient is there. Resistance hypertension, we give spironolactone, but even after the spironolactone, patient blood pressure is still high. So always rule out non-compliance. Non-compliance means patient might be taking salt in the diet. It might not be a visible salt. It can be like pickles, papad, patient is taking. So ask history of these dietary food items if the BP is still high. So rule out that. Motivate the patient for lifestyle modifications. Ask the patient to take medicines same time each day, whatever time patient is taking. The drugs which can be given are centrally acting drugs, and the dose of these centrally acting drugs like clonidine 0.1 to 0.3, two times or maybe three times we can also give. Moxonidine we can give 0.2 to 0.4, one or twice in a day can be given. Now these are the common side effect of the medications which you should tell to your patients, because patient might complain of headache, flushing episodes or edema. Because with edema, patient become very scared ki edema is there, might be kidney failure is there, heart failure is there. But reassure the patient that if edema develops, this is a side effect of calcium channel blocker. Patient do complain of headaches. So if patient is having persistent headache, sleep is disturbed, then you should change calcium channel blocker in that scenario. Same for ACE inhibitor. If patient is having dry irritating cough, then change ACE inhibitor to ARB. The chances will be less in that condition. Postural hypotension is common with alpha blockers. Besides that, ACE inhibitor and ARB do cause postural hypotension. And be very careful about the hyperkalemia in ACE inhibitor and ARB cases. Angioedema with ACE inhibitor is common. In diabetes patient, there can be high glucose level with the use of diuretics. So they can cause, as well as beta blocker, they can impair the glycemic control. So be careful about the comorbid condition of the patient and keep monitoring these side effects in patients. Now, the last question, can we stop antihypertensive medications in our patient? Because patient always tell you ki doctor sahab meri medicine itni chal rahi hai to band kar sakte hain hum medication. So can we stop antihypertensive medication? So as such, there are no clear cut valid guidelines ki can we stop the antihypertensive, or if we are stopping, how to stop. There are no clear cut guidelines, but do not stop antihypertensive before 1 year of BP control. Never do that. So do not stop before 1 year of BP control unless patient is having hypotension episodes, symptomatic hypotension. Yes, if patient has symptomatic hypotension, then you have to taper or stop the antihypertensive medication. But if there are no episodes, BP is under control for 1 year, then you can try tapering the doses and stopping the doses of antihypertensive medications. Tapering is important rather than sudden withdrawal. Like if amlodipine patient is taking 5 mg, do not stop it immediately. Make it 2.5. Make it 2.5 and then stop. And how frequently the tapering should be done? It can be done like not before 1 month. Not before 1 month you should taper the dose. So only after 1 month you try to taper these doses. Withdrawal start with the last dose which we have added. Like if we have started with telmisartan, then we have added calcium channel blocker, then we have diuretic. So start tapering the diuretic first, followed by CCB, followed by ARB or ACE inhibitor. So this is a broad framework of tapering the or stopping the antihypertensive medication. But always keep the patient under a follow-up. So if patient is willing to come for a frequent follow-up, then try to stop or taper the drug. Otherwise, no. Otherwise, no. Because rebound hypertension have high side effects like stroke. So this was the presentation on antihypertensive medications. So do share your experience and any recommendation, any feedback you can put in the comment section. Thank you, all of you.